everyone. Welcome to There Will Be Blood at the North Texas Teen Book Festival. Yay! I'm Mandy Aguilar, and I'll be your moderator today. I'm a librarian at Irving Public Library in beautiful Irving, Texas, and I also serve on the NTTBF Steering Committee. I'm thrilled that you're joining us for our first virtual festival. And while it feels weird broadcasting from my house instead of in person at the Irving Convention Center, I know that this will be an amazing panel. But before we begin, I want to remind all of you that our NTTBF swag shop is open on our website, and you can also purchase the books that you'll be hearing about today on our website, poweredbybookshop.org. So make sure that you check those out. Now we have our panelists here, and I would love for each of you to introduce yourselves and tell us just a little bit about the book that you're here to talk about. And whoever wants to go first can, or I can nominate someone.
Nominate.
Volunteer as tribute. My name is Ashley Poston, and you most know me for my Once Upon a Con series, Geekerella, Princess and the Fangirl, and wow, that sun is bright. But I am here to talk about Among the Beasts and Briars. It is about two idiots who go for a hike in the woods, and I'm just going to get really washed out. I'm sorry, guys. This is, it's fine. I'm just going to blend into the background now. But yeah, thank y'all for letting me come. I'm so excited.
We're glad to have you. Okay, next tribute.
I'll go.
All right.
And I just have to say, like she said, two idiots who go for a walk in the woods. And I'm like, and then? I'm so interested. Had me there.
Dun, dun, dun.
Had me. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Namina Forna. I am from Sierra Leone, West Africa, born and raised, came to America when I was 9. My book is called The Gilded Ones. It's a young adult fantasy set in an African-inspired world that is deeply patriarchal. And in this world, there are a group of girls who are faster and stronger than regular people and bleed gold. And because of this, everyone thinks that they're demons. But then actual demons come into this world and the humans are like, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. We need these girls, haha, to fight these demons. And so they offer the girls a choice, fight or die. My main character, Deka, decides to fight, and in doing so, goes off on an adventure that changes her life. So basically the way that I like to tell people how to sort of think about this book is like, if the Dora Milaje from Black Panther were stuck in the world of The Handmaid's Tale and said, burn everything down. What is about The Gilded Ones.
That is the best pitch ever.
I love it.
I'm so glad I went before you.
I know, I'm like, you can go.
Ladies first.
Oh man.
Okay. I can go if you want.
You can go. You go for it.
Okay, cool. Hi, I'm Adam Silvera. I write a lot of gay stuff, and including my new fantasy series, which is a trilogy. The first book is Infinity Sun. It is shiny. The second book is Infinity Reaper, which is out this week. They are, one is way bigger than the other. But the Infinity Cycle is the name of the series, and it follows these two brothers, Emil and Brighton, and explores what happens when one brother gets powers and the other one doesn't. And Emil is sort of like our queer chosen one who absolutely does not want these powers. And his brother Brighton is very fame obsessed and is growing very, very envious of his brother. And there's a cute shapeshifter in it. There's a badass girl. It's if you want an X-Men to be a little queerer, Infinity Cycle.
Perfect.
You had me at shapeshifter.
Yeah.
Yay.
Sure. Okay, right. I am Shelby Mahurin, and I wrote Serpent and Dove on Blood and Honey. This is my most recent book, and the forthcoming Gods and Monsters comes out in August. These are young adult fantasy novels. They follow a witch and a witch hunter who are bound together in holy matrimony, and they are also navigating the sort of ancient war between coven and church. That's my elevator pitch.
Love it.
Spicy.
It is.
And I love witches and witch hunters so much, so I'm ready to binge.
Yeah. Based on your wallpaper, honestly.
Yeah.
Like, you don't have to say anything. Your wallpaper is just kind of like, I'm
gonna... It's kind of distracting. It's so pretty, right?
It's like the entire aesthetic is just, I'm like, I'm here in like my childhood bedroom and you're like in a posh room with this like amazing wallpaper. And I'm like, I'm not tall enough to ride this ride.
I am not posh. 30 seconds before I came on here, I was like, I'm redoing my bedroom. So I was like pushing aside furniture. My laptop right now is like propped up on like boxes. it's not posh.
That makes me feel a lot better.
All right. So I've cooked up a few questions for our authors, and I also have questions that were submitted before the festival by our audience, our teen viewers. And our first question happens to be one of those teen questions, and it's for Namina. It's from Yasmin at Dobie Ninth Grade Campus, and Yasmin wanted to know what inspired you to write The Gilded Ones and what made you come up with all of the events that happen in the story.
Hi, Yasmin. So I wrote The Gilded Ones because I was mad. People always say that this is the book of my heart, and I'm like, no. This is the book of my rage, okay? Because I grew up in Sierra Leone, West Africa, and I grew up during a war. And it was not a fun time. And it was especially not a fun time for women. So I grew up sort of understanding that my body was always sort of under threat. And then I came to America and I experienced purity culture here. And I started to look at it and I was like, what happened in Sierra Leone, what's happening in America, it's all the same thing. It's just more polite. Here people are just, they're more like, they say nicer things about it, but they're still doing sort of the exact same thing. So I went to a school called Spelman College, which is all female and all Black. And while I was there, I took classes on feminism and religion. And these classes sort of really helped me shape my mind. So all of these things sort of swirl together, along with the one other thing, which is when I was at Spelman, I used to have this recurring dream. And it was this girl, and she's wearing golden armor, and she's walking up a battlefield, slow motion, like looking like she's gonna kick some major ass. And the dream always cuts out, but I was just like, I don't know who she is, but she is amazing. And so with sort of my background and just her, like all of these things I think sort of swirl together. And I created this book where I really wanted to talk about what it means to grow as a marginalized person in a patriarchy. You know, and I wanted to examine what does a patriarchy look like, who falls into it, who benefits from it, how is it constructed, who keeps sort of, you know, furthering it. And how do people suffer or not suffer under it? And so that's sort of where The Gilded Ones came from, but mainly came because I was pissed off at just what it means to be a woman in this world. And I wanted to talk about it.
Thank you. It's amazing. My next question is for Ashley. Ashley, Among the Beasts and Briars has been likened to familiar classical fairy tales that we grew up with. And we know that there are a lot of tropes involved in fairy tales. Were there any pitfalls for you writing in this genre? Or were you confident when breaking and bending some of those rules?
Well, I came from writing contemporary fairy tales to writing a fantasy fairy tale. And I found that it was a lot easier in fantasy because I could just make up what I wanted to. And like, I didn't have to have a patriarchy in this kingdom. Like I didn't, the fairy tales didn't have to be modeled after our like very oppressive history, like throughout fairy tales, because fairy tales were created to like teach a story. Like Beauty and the Beast was created to teach women that like they need to be subservient to like whoever they decided to marry. And so like I like taking those kind of tropes and I like flipping them on their head. And I also really like Diana Wynne Jones and what she did with like fairy tales. And I wanted to sort of like bring that to a more like fantasy scape. That's basically, it was easy. It was fine. It was fun. It was fine. No worries.
I love hearing it was easy. We don't always hear that.
I mean, like at the exact same time I was writing Bookish and the Beast, which was a lot harder because I was like, I can't do most of this because it's Stockholm syndrome. So like it, like, Among the Beasts and Briars is a Beauty and the Beast-esque retelling, but it's not as faithful as Bookish and the Beast, just because I didn't want to fall into all those pitfalls. And I was like, well, what if we went to the, like, OG Beauty and the Beast, where the Beast was just this, like, bumbling oaf nice guy. He was basically a himbo, right? I wanted to see what my version of Beauty and the Beast would look like if, like, the Beast wasn't like an oppressive monster of a guy. So
I think that goes really well into our next audience question, which is from Laura at Jasper High School, and it's for anyone who wants to answer it. And she asks, how do you control the balance of bloodlust, rage, and empathy in a character? And is there a point where they cross the line and become too cruel and unrecognizable?
I think yes. I think that it's a fine line that you have to walk. And I'm not, like, a proponent of a protagonist who has to be likable. I think that unlikable protagonists are important too, but at the same time, there has to be a note of empathy there, or the reader isn't going to care about the protagonist if they are literally slaughtering everyone with no sort of, like, moral code at all. I think it can be hard.
Yeah, I have a character in the Infinity Cycle. His name is Brighton, and he's the character that people just hate. Like, there are four narrators, and he's the, like, unlikable one, you know? And I'm like, it's because he's uncomfortably real, and I think if a lot of us were more honest, you know, we would understand that as well. But then there are tons of readers who love Brighton, and they, like, empathize with him, and they absolutely understand that. And Brighton makes, like, a really questionably moral choice at the end of Infinity Sun, and in Infinity Reaper, like, I do my best to make it clear, like, hi, it wasn't just for this reason. Like, there's, like, a real human engine, like, within him that, like, help push him towards this thing. Like, he has his own fears, he has his own sort of ambitions as well. But yeah, I mean, I am really careful with that, but also understanding that, like, I don't approve of these choices just because, like, this character's, like, doing this thing or saying this thing, like, does not mean that it's, like, a reflection of me. But I think it's true for a lot of people.
I like that you said they have to have, like, a human engine in there. I think that's very important.
Gotta rev it.
Yeah.
I completely agree, because first of all, there is a line. You can cross it very easily, in fact. And I think also one of the things that we should look at is, what is the character's reasoning? What is the reason for their blood loss? Because, mm-hmm. like, in The Gilded Ones, Deka, I would say, kills a lot of people but doesn't have bloodlust, because she has been told this is what she needs to do to win her place in society. And then when she figures out other things, it's like she never kills without a purpose, and she never kills without somebody coming at her first, mm-hmm. you know? And I think that that's sort of an important distinction versus somebody who's like, yeah, I'm just going to murder everyone and it's going to be great. Which is also a valid character, not a character you can empathize with, but, you know, that's also a character. That's a choice. But I wouldn't say that's a choice that makes a hero, because it could make a protagonist a main character, but that's not a hero main character.
Yeah. I think about that so much too, especially in YA novels, because we have so many protagonists that are just killing. Like, I mean, when you think about the amount of people that, like, Katniss is just kind of, like, killed and, like, nameless or whatever, right? It's kind of like, it's going to weigh on you, and it does weigh on her. Like, I think that's clear. But there, every time I see, like, a random, like, henchman or whatever that, like, falls, like, you know, victim to one of our heroes or whatever, I just still can't help,
like, that was someone's, like, father, that was someone's son.
That's, yeah, and, like, exactly. Emil, our, like, chosen one who doesn't want to be chosen or whatever, like, he thinks about that a lot. Like, I tell everyone, like, a successful victory for Emil in this series would be if he can get through the entire series without killing anybody. Like, he does not want to be that person, you know? And other people, like, he surrounds himself with, even the heroes, right? Like, they, not heroes, they are the heroes, not quotes, but even the heroes have, like, found blood on their hands, you know? And, you know, we study the way that they all sort of, like, justify it, right? Like, it's either self-defense or we had to be proactive against this villain, basically. And it's still really tricky territory. And, you know, like, for me, I'm like, I just can't see myself killing people. So I don't know. I think it's an interesting examination for sure, especially throughout YA, where it's a bloodbath sometimes.
Also, it's like really interesting because, like, when you're writing fantasy, you get to create like the moral code of that world as well. And so, like, you can operate with a main character who, like, in this society, like, killing someone is not bad or wrong, because you can like make a world that thinks that. But still, like, with a reader, with our moral judgment, is like, oh, that's still wrong. But to the reader, it might not be. So it's also, well, I mean, to the character, it might not be. So it's like we're trying to balance that out, because in Among the Beasts and Briars, there's not a lot of death. There's like one person who dies, maybe, we don't know. But there is a lot of like change that occurs into like these like monstrous sort of beings, and that's basically like a death. The forest which they venture into, they like, the forest itself thinks it's like comeuppance, basically, that, oh, you took something from us, so we get to take something from you. And yeah, just like building worlds that like have a different moral compass than ours does is also really tricky. And it's kind of fun too, because you can like write worlds where you can just like slaughter, you know, 300 people or whatever. It's like, yeah, no, you're a hero, good job, A+, you know. But I like the books that that like wrestle with that, and like also like compare it to our own morality. Does that make sense? Am I rambling? I feel like I'm rambling.
No. I mean, no, that makes total sense, because in The Gilded Ones, The Gilded Ones is a very violent book. I always tell people this, like, be prepared, it is a very violent book. But I'm always very careful with the violence, because one of the things is I always want to make sure that people see, what are the consequences of violence? Like, what happens, like, how does the character deal with the things that she has to do, which is actually one of the main thrusts of the novel, is like, when you do these things, what are the consequences? What are the mental consequences? Because there have, like, for me personally, there have to be consequences, especially in a world like Otera, the world in my book.
Exactly. And it's like so fun to like play with that too, and to have like a conversation with it.
We're going to switch gears here real quick and talk about craft a little bit, in a question that I have for Adam and Shelby. The two of you are in the middle of a series. Infinity Reaper and Blood and Honey are the second book. And I'm wondering if a lot has changed from your initial idea through these first two books and into the third, and if there has been any reader response from the first book that has helped sort of tweak or guide your way.
You go ahead.
I love that question.
That's a loaded question. There's a lot
there. Yeah, it is. Like, I'm like, I don't even know which ones to hit first, but it's a fantastic question. And because this is, Infinity Sun is my fifth book and Infinity Reaper is my sixth book. But it's my first time doing a series, and it's my first time doing fantasy. And, you know, I think there were some like with Infinity Sun, I know like some readers struggle with the fact that I didn't like spoon feed them every world building detail, because I, when writing the book, I'm like, I don't write it in a way that's like, how do I make this most comfortable to the reader? I write it in, how can I make it the voice most authentic to the character? You know, like if I have a character who's just like all of a sudden dropping like 8 paragraphs on some world building detail that's actually not that fundamental to the plot that I'm telling or whatever, that to me feels like really kind of like, I don't know, just like overly generous storytelling, and can be actually really distracting to the reader, because like as you're introducing them to a new world, like you're asking them to sort of absorb all these details and assuming that they're all going to be important. like by the end, and it's like, not really, you know. And so I don't like stop and explain everything, especially with characters who are born in that world, right? Like, this is not some portal fantasy where they're discovering everything. Like, in the same way that when writing contemporary, I don't stop and explain what a cell phone is, because we just know, and that is like what is true with my character's perspective. But you know, I understood that like that didn't necessarily work for a lot of readers, and I wanted to expand the world some more, which leads to why one book is almost twice the size of the first.
I love that.
And it's like, cool, you guys want to world build it here. Leave me alone. But I appreciate that, right? Because like, as a writer, like I do take my craft like really seriously, and I do get my intentions. But like, I do want it to work. I do want you to be able to like relax into the world and everything. And so much has changed, and also people wanted more romance. So the romance got really dialed up in book two in a way that I wasn't necessarily planning just yet. There were some big moments that I was going to save for book three, and I wanted to kind of hit them sooner, you know? And I love that too, because one of my friends, writer Amy Kaufman, she told me years ago, she was like, you will have new ideas. You know, like, don't be afraid to like use some of your like bigger ideas sooner. Like, new things like will blossom from that. And I'm really excited to see what comes out of book three now, knowing that I've like played some of my book three cards in book two.
Are you writing book three right now? Are you in the middle of that process?
I have not started yet, which is unfortunate, because now that Infinity Reaper is out, I now have to like absorb everyone else's opinions on that book before I start. But you know, I think I know how to like pick and choose like what I actually agree with. And there are a lot of criticisms that people have had about my books before. I'm like, oh, that's just an Adam thing, and that's not going to change, you mm-hmm. know? But yeah, how about you now that you have like completed the trilogy?
I love what you said about knowing what critique to take and what critique to leave, because some things you just like, you know, and like, that's the story you wanted to tell. I approached Serpent and Dove and Blood and Honey much differently. This is my first series, so it's my first sort of like trip around the merry-go-round. I wrote Serpent and Dove in my own little bubble. It was very fun. It's very tropey. It's very, a lot of people compared it to like fan fiction. It read like fan fiction. And I didn't know whether that was a good thing or a bad thing. Like you, I had to rewrite Blood and Honey. So, I was writing it as Serpent and Dove came out, and I was like receiving my first outside feedback. And I didn't really know what to do with a lot of it. So also, like you, one of the things that people really wanted in the second book was world building. So I was like, all right, I can world build. I can do it. So with Blood and Honey, I plotted a lot more. And it was more of a, like, I had to hit all of the story beats of like Save the Cat. I was a lot more methodical with Blood and Honey, which worked for some people and it didn't work for some people. And I've learned, having published both books now, maybe not to be as reactionary in my storytelling as I was with Blood and Honey. Like, okay, people didn't like this about Serpent and Dove, so I'm going to change it in Blood and Honey. You have to be careful with that, just because if you focus on your weaknesses, I think that you can, you know, shore up your weaknesses, but then you also sort of forget about your strengths and you like go a different direction. So with Gods and Monsters, I think that I did find my style and my method and everything. And I'm really excited about Gods and Monsters. But two very different books in the same series, which throws some people, but hopefully Gods and Monsters sort of like weaves them together.
Yeah, I love that. I really,
whoever told you that fanfic, sorry, is like not viable. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I actually hadn't read a lot of fanfic, so I didn't know. I'm like, what do I do with this? Is that a good thing? Is it a bad thing? I don't know.
Good thing. There's a reason AO3 exists.
Yeah.
Sorry, Adam. I didn't mean to
interrupt. Oh, no. I was just going to say, like, I can't imagine, because I know that like a lot of the criticisms really hit me hard with Infinity Sun, and that was my fifth book, right? Mm-hmm. And I can't imagine taking that on as a debut. And I've thought about that a lot. I'm like, I'm so happy this wasn't my first book, because I think I would have quit. I think it would have been like, oh, publishing is not for me. Like I used to write fan fiction like for years where it was like really celebrated and stuff too. But like, I think I would have been like, oh no, this is like too brutal. And so I'm glad that I had like the opportunity to sort of like work my way up to, you know, what essentially feels like a different debut since it's like first time in like fantasy. But yeah, I'm happy that you got through it, and I'm gonna like cheering for you as
you get through. I've never read fan fiction.
You've never read?
I hadn't read a lot of it.
I don't like when people are like AO3, I don't know what that is.
Do you want Rex? Like, do you have a favorite TV show? I got him. I mean,
I don't know.
AO3 is an archive of our own. It was a small independent website that was created on a shoestring budget by a bunch of women in fandom who wanted a place where they could like put their really horny fanfic. And so they found it, and like it's been celebrated as like this website that has some of the most inclusive tags on any fanfic website. Like there's a lot of librarians who really appreciate the tagging system because it's so expansive. And it won, what did it win? It won an award last
year. Oh yeah, I remember. I'm blanking too, but yeah.
Nebula or something? It was one of the sci-fi and fantasy awards, but no, Hugo, yeah. It won a Hugo, wow. Yeah. for its like inclusivity and everything, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah. One day I will delve into it. One day. Yeah.
If you ever want Rex, just let me know.
Yes, definitely.
Namina, I have a question for you. You went to film school and you have a background in screenwriting, and I wanted to know, it's another craft question, how did that influence your writing or your storytelling style when you were writing The Gilded Ones?
So I wanted to be a novelist first, and I decided to become a novelist in undergrad. And I wrote my first couple of novels and sent them off and nothing. This was back in the days when people were like, Black people don't sell books. So I was like, let me go to film school because I will figure out hopefully there a career that I can do that'll make me happy while I'm trying to pursue this novelist pipe dream. And I say all this to say that basically it's funny because it seems that my novel writing actually made me a better screenwriter. Because like when I came in ready off the bat because I'd had so much practice already telling stories. But I will say that the thing that film school did is, number one, the first thing they tell you in film school is kill your babies. Oh, you're attached to this, you love this, this is the one thing that you can't do without in your story. Well, young person, how does this relate to the rest of the story? Oh, it doesn't? Then kill your baby. That is the first thing that they tell you in film school. And like, it sort of makes it, I think, number one, it makes it, I take critique, particularly if it comes from someone I trust very, very well, because I understand there's a difference between myself and the work. And that's one of the things that film school teaches you. The other thing is structure. In film, and this is actually one of the things where I struggled with in rewriting, because The Gilded Ones, I wrote it in 2012, tossed it out, and then I did it from scratch again. And the one that I did from scratch was the one that I sold. One of the things is I was so used to film structure, and like film structure is like you have max 115 to 121 pages to write a movie, right? So like you have to hit all these beats in this time, and they're like, and you have to like have certain beats done by certain pages. So when I was writing The Gilded Ones, or doing the rewrite rather, like I kept trying to approach it the way I would a film, which is, oh, by page 16, inciting incident. And like my editors had to be like, Namina, tap, tap, actually, we need to spend a little bit more time in the world before, you know, you get to the beheading and all this stuff. And I was like, oh, okay. So then I had to, and I struggled with this because I'm like, I feel like I've already established the world. What are you talking about? So I had to go back and like sort of slow the pace a little bit. I think the other way that being, having a film background has influenced me is that one of the things that I struggled with in the beginning when I was writing was that I was this person who would just word vomit like all of the descriptions and be like, you know, like in the fair world of this and that, like, and have like all these names and whatever. But like in writing a script, like basically it's a blueprint. You have to get there and keep it pushing, and also not give people so much information that they're like, what in the world is going on? And so I think that's translated into my novel writing in that I'm very sparing about details. Like, for instance, if I'm like writing a battle scene, you'll notice I never actually write out like every single thing that happens. I focus more on the character's emotional state and then give you enough so that you fill in the blanks. And I think that's like one of, I think the best thing that I've learned from writing scripts is that leave enough room for the reader's imagination to fill in, right? So you give, let's say you give like 75 to 80% and then everybody fills in and the reader then fills in whatever else is left. And there it then becomes a collaboration between you and the reader because they're also doing the work of fleshing out the world. So, yeah.
I love that. Yeah.
For all of you, and kind of in tying in with the theme of this panel, each of your books features something about blood very prominently. And I wanted to know, what is it that is so fascinating or so magical about blood? A weird question that I never thought I would ask.
Blood in my book specifically or just blood in general?
You can make it specific to your book if you'd like.
We all have it.
Wait, no, that's water. I was about to say H2O and I was like, wait a minute, that's water.
We're just living sacks of blood.
Yeah,
I don't know, someone else.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I don't know, I'm gonna just start talking and see if like something really like cool comes from it, but just to fill the silence, I don't do well with silence. So in my world, there are two different kinds of magical people. There are people called celestials who are born with powers that just completely have like wide range. And then there are specters who were once regular people who stole the blood of magical creatures such as like phoenixes, hydras, basilisks, and kind of like absorb their powers and transform them a little bit. And I was originally writing this book as like a dark fairy tale for kids, like about like 10 years ago. And it always like centered around this big alchemical formula called Reaper's Blood. Which basically, like, if you drink a potion that's known as Reaper's Blood, you would become invincible. And that requires, like, the blood of a firstborn phoenix. So a phoenix that has had no other lifetimes before, the blood of a hydra who has never been decapitated, and the blood of your family. And from the ghosts of your family, excuse me. And just for, like, a pure ritual of like purity and everything. And I just like, I don't know, like, I mean, Ashley's joking, right? Like that we all have it, but I'm like, it is interesting if your blood like can present like different like magical powers and everything. And I just like always thought that was like an interesting thing to sort of like play around with. And and especially like in a magical world, like it's gutting to me to kind of like see like a phoenix get harmed. Like phoenixes are like my favorite magical creature. I've had this like phoenix tattoo phoenix tattoo since I was 19 years old. And I just like, now I have this like Chosen One series about a boy with phoenix blood within him. And I get to live out my sort of like phoenix fantasies like through it, I don't know. But yeah, it's a great question. I'm going to sit on it some more and probably have a really solid answer the moment we sign off.
I mean, like, yeah, I was definitely joking, but also I really like the thought of how family doesn't have to be blood relation. It's kind of like tangential to your question, but like I like those kind of like found family stories where like blood is not as important as like how you form a relationship with someone. So yeah, that's kind of like how I like to interact with like the blood in my story. Like, so of course Karis has like cursed blood, but it's not really her cursed blood comes from the fact that she like survived this terrible ordeal and all this stuff, and she can just grow plants, which is fun, I guess. But I really like exploring like what brings a group of people together to form like a found family narrative.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting. Blood is, to go along with the thread of we all have it, it is interesting because it's sort of, especially in fantasy novels, becomes a person's essence. It's a very like, it's easily understood that it's like what's inside of a person. And like you said, Adam, like if it presents different powers, it's this thing that we all have that's still different, which is a lot of fun to play around with.
I think that for me, I approached blood very sort of specifically in the world of the Gilded Ones. So in my book, there are these girls, they're called Alaki, and they bleed golden blood. They're faster and stronger than regular people. And each has one way they can die, sort of like an Achilles heel, meaning that say, for instance, if this one girl, her death is cutting off her pinky finger, you could literally do what you want. Until you cut off her pinky finger, she's not going to die. And the reason why I chose the blood, I made the blood gold, was when I was approaching this book, I wanted to talk about the commodification of women, meaning the idea that women, we are seen by our monetary value, right? So like when you look at a woman down the street, most people like, or rather one of the awful things that people do is they rank, you know, women as like, you know, how attractive she is, how young she is, how this, and all of these things sort of translate to monetary value. And I really wanted to talk about this idea because so often girls, especially all across the world, are seen in terms of what they bring to the table, not only for their families, but for their communities or what have you. And when I was thinking about this, I was like, what is the easiest way to make this metaphor known? And I was like, wait a minute, their blood is gold, right? And so in the book, awful things happen to these girls and they're sentenced to death. But like one of the sad things that happens is like people literally bleed them for their gold because the blood that comes out of their bodies is liquid gold that will turn solid and can be, you know, traded for money. And so I talk about this in like so many different ways of just this idea of blood meaning your worth as a person, as a woman. So that's how I sort of came to the idea of having golden blood in this book.
You guys did great with that question. I think it's-
you all did great with that question. I just said stuff. But seriously, I'm like, even just hearing you guys talk about it, I'm like, oh my God, I need to read all these books. Now I'm
dude,
like,
your answer was so good. What are you talking about?
I wouldn't have had my answer unless you had your answers.
Okay. Don't put yourself down. You were good.
I was fishing. I needed that attention and that praise. I received it. Thank you. We're good.
Okay, I'm going to switch to a reader question from Eveth at Lady Bird Johnson Middle School. And she has a question about inclusivity. She wanted to know why it's important to feature LGBTQ or Black Lives Matter themes in fantasy stories. Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
Yes, I don't want to like immediately jump first if someone else wants to go.
It's the same. I'm like, I'm gonna wait.
I feel like I answered the last one first, so it's like, I'm a.
Technically, I answered the last one first.
Oh, you did. You did. Yes, we all have blood. Correct.
It was a cop out. I'm sorry.
Cool. You're a hero.
For me, it's very simple. I did not see myself in a book until I was 30. I never read of a person that looked like me in a book until I was 30. And for the most part, even when I saw people that were tangential to me, we were sidekicks. We were, you know, we only came in because the main character needed saving, but we were always incidental. Like if we were added, it was like a, see, we have a Black person here, look, you know, it was always sort of grudging. And for me, that's why I write very inclusive worlds, because I think it is important to always show people, especially young people, especially kids and teens, that they are seen, that they are wanted, and that they are welcomed. That is why in every single one of my worlds, you will find people who are differently abled. You will find people who are queer. You will find people who are trans. You will find people who are Black, Brown, and all just different races and ethnicities. You'll find people who are Indigenous. And that's not something that's incidental. That is something that I do purposefully on design. Like, whenever I approach a book, I look at it and I'm like, do I have all these people represented? And even if I don't say it, or I don't like, expressly examine that person in the first book, because I tend to write, trilogies or series. That's the word I was searching for. I was like, what is it?
It's a series. What's a line of books called that come after one another?
Yes, exactly. So even if like I don't say it in like the first book or whatever, they're always there. They're always, always, always there. And it's so important to me, because like growing up, like I would spend all this time in other people's worlds. You know, like when I was growing up in Sierra Leone, because I grew up in Sierra Leone, again, I grew up during a war. And like when I was growing up, how I felt safe was I would read constantly. That's all I would do. And that was the one way that I felt safe. And that's why I became an author, was because I wanted to do that for other people. Like I really wanted to make sure that across the world, kids can read my book, or teens can read my books, and know that in that instance that they are supported and that they're held in my world. For however long that they're in my world, they are supported, they're held, and most importantly, they're wanted and seen.
I love that so much, and that's really good. Super agree with it. Like, I mean, for me, I didn't see a queer character in a novel until I was like 19 years old, and I was reading Cassandra Clare's City of Bones, you know, like the very first book that kicked off the entire Shadowhunters universe, right? And I was a Barnes & Noble bookseller at the time. And I was like the slowest reader. I also like wasn't seeking out like contemporary queer novels at that time, because I have always loved fantasy. Like for me, it's like really shocking that it took me 5 books to like publish a fantasy novel, you know? And like, I grew up like magical stories and everything. And but I also, most importantly, like didn't feel comfortable walking into sort of like these like really isolated LGBT sections of the store at the time, just LGBT, because that's what booksellers were categorizing it as. And I was just never going to be seen with that, because I felt like that would have outed me, you know, but like before I'd like come out and everything. So, but to then be reading City of Bones, and I just like, I've told the story for years, like there was the shadow hunter Alec, and I just remember getting like a gay vibe from him, but I thought for sure I was projecting it, you know? And then all of a sudden there's like a bisexual warlock, and they're like their thing. And I am one of the slowest readers like ever. Like I don't have the attention. And I blasted through like each of those like 400 or 500 page books, like within trilogy collectively within like a week. And I was like excited about all the like Mortal Cup, demon angel war stuff, whatever, like that was like all great and good, but like I was obsessed with like the demon hunter and the bisexual warlock and like that shit, you know? And like that was like so huge for me, and I didn't know that we could do that. And like even the fantasy story that I tried writing for sort of like different Infinity Sun novel like over 10 years ago, whatever, I was writing straight protagonists because that's what I thought I was allowed to do, you know? And now all my books have like queer characters and everything. And I understand that is such a kind of like a risky choice even for my career, because there's a gigantic demographic in this country that will never pick up my books. There are countries that will never acquire the rights to publish them within their, you know, within their territories and everything. And I'm like, I'm not going to write straight stuff. Like that is like, that catalog is like well stocked. Like you don't need me adding to that, you know? And I get people asking me like, are you gonna write this? I'm like, no, but I can direct you to literally every other author who's like publishing books with like heterosexual like protagonists and everything. And what I love most now, especially with the Infinity Cycle, it's like, it is this queer trilogy that like has these like cool actiony covers or whatever. And you don't necessarily even know, because I was like, I want to trick straight people. I want straight people to see this cover and pick up this book because they're like, oh, it looks cool. And they're all of a sudden reading a book that has four narrators, of which three are queer. And they're like, oh, cool, I can enjoy stories about like queer people and everything, you know? And I also just want us to be the hero. Like, I love reading about those characters as like secondary characters or whatever, but I'm like, I want to be the protagonist, you know? And that's one of my like core reasons for why I continue to publish books the way that I do.
Yeah. It's so important. It's so important for people. You said it was a risky decision for your career because there's a huge demographic that's never going to pick up your book. It's so important for them to pick up your book. I live in the middle of Indiana. It is a majority white, cisgendered, heterosexual like area. There is not a lot of diversity where I live, and that's how it was when I grew up. And so reading was the only way as a teen, as even like younger than that.
Did Indiana take her away?
Yeah. What happened? Am I the only one seeing this? What's going on?
She's back.
Oh, am I back? Did I go away?
You froze for a second.
For a hot second there.
I was still talking. Did
yeah? You had said about like even younger than that, and then you
yeah, froze. Even younger than that. Reading was the only way that I was able to see people who were different than me, because they weren't around me. Like I didn't have the opportunity to see different perspectives because of where I lived. So it's so important for that demographic to pick up your book and to read it and to absorb it.
Yeah, for me it was so I am very gay as well. when I was younger, I never really saw myself like reflected like sexuality wise in anything until Buffy, actually. And we're not going to talk about Whedon whatsoever, but like just Tara was like the only representation we had, right? And so that like wasn't like the butt of a joke. So that was really important to me. And then I found fanfic. And like for me, like I was a huge fanfic reader starting in middle school, because I found like I could explore queerness and what it meant and identity within these worlds, within these like spaces that were created by people who are also like searching and seeking and trying to figure out themselves. And it was a community that I did not have in nowhere South Carolina, that was like very, very white, very straight, very Republican. So it was very important for me, and it's still important for me to like reflect that in my stories. The main couple in Among the Beasts and Briars is heterosexual, but I wrote Karis as Ace because I am Ace. So that was really important to me. And so when people ask, oh, are there any sexy times? And I'm like, not really. there's no squelching, I'm sorry. So
did you say squelching?
Did you say squelching?
Is this what people are expecting for books now?
Yeah. Yeah.
I have no idea. Like I've had readers be like, so how sexy is this one? And I'm like, there's no blood play if that's what you're asking.
Oh my god.
But yeah, it was really important for me to like find that queer community online, and especially in fanfic. And so I wasn't really a big reader growing up, but I've read so much fanfic that was so questionable. But you know what? I think I turned out pretty well and well balanced. But yeah, it's very important for me, especially in the next book in the series of Among the Beasts and Briars. It involves a queer couple, and I'm just so excited to finally bring them to life. I'm so happy.
Those were great answers. Thank you. And thank you for being so honest with our viewers. That's so important, and we really appreciate it.
I'm going to turn the light on really quick. It's yes. so like gloomy here, and the sun.
I just thought that was your aesthetic.
Let me turn all the lights off in this room.
Goes with the wallpaper.
Look, all I'm saying is that her entire aesthetic just fits her books so well that it's like it was staged. I love it. I love it so much.
Is that a little better?
Yes. I can get
my ring.
Okay. Do you think I should get my ring light or not?
I think you're good.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have just a couple of minutes left before we need to wrap up. And so I have a couple of just short, fun questions for you guys. I hope they're fun. Maybe they're not. Who knows? We'll find out. I wanted to know, what would be your reaction if you saw someone cosplay one of your characters?
I have.
You did?
Yeah. Not in Among the Beasts and Briars, but people have come up to me at Dragon Con and San Diego Comic Con cosplaying Princess Amara from the Geekerella series. And it's just, I love it so much. And I've seen people cosplay as Elle and Darien and like Sage and like even Frank. It's so weird. It blows my mind. I love it so much.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of people dress up as Mateo Torres from They Both Die at the End, especially on TikTok, which has been really cool.
Yeah, I've seen some cosplayers dressed up as Lou and Reed and Coco. Even some were gone. Actually, I attended Y'all Fest before the pandemic, just as a reader. I had published Serpent and Dove at that time, and I was walking down the street and someone recognized me, which was just bizarre. I was like, me? I was like looking over my shoulder. And she was actually dressed up as Lou at the time that I met her. And I was just like,
wow.
Yeah.
So cool.
It was the most surreal moment, I think, probably to this day that I've had. I was just like, yeah, I'm Lou. And I was like, I know. Like, what is going on?
I've seen people cosplay the Alaki, and I am absolutely delighted every time I see it. I'm like, more Alaki, yeah.
So much fun.
I wanted to know what your favorite TV show you've watched during the pandemic was.
I made
WandaVision. Like, absolutely WandaVision.
Okay. I found it's an older show, Timeless. Have you guys heard of Timeless?
I love Timeless!
Yeah.
I discovered it and I binged it all, and now I'm watching it again because I loved it so much.
I'm so sad it ended.
I am too. I'm very upset about some of the things with the ending because it was canceled. They had to wrap it up, but
yeah,
it's still a great show.
Also a huge fan of WandaVision. Really love That May Destroy You. I finally watched Newsroom. I've been rewatching Veep like on a loop. It's like my favorite show. And I've watched a lot of TV. Like I'm blanking right now for sure.
I absolutely loved I May Destroy You. And recently I've been watching Pushing Daisies again, which is one of my favorite shows ever. Like I love everything about it, and it always makes me so happy.
It's really good.
Those are all great choices.
I've also been watching a lot of anime, but I'm sure no one wants to hear about that one.
Oh, yes, we do. I've like watched like literally every show.
Oh my God.
Right now I'm saving like the last season of Attack on Titan because I'm like, I can't wait. Like I watch one episode at a time. I'm not playing those games.
It's blowing my mind. It's so much.
Okay, so can I say one anime that has absolutely delighted me has been Sleeping Princess in Demon Castle.
Yes!
It's so cute! It's so amazing. Like, this is like, it's such a delightful show. And it's delightful because here, like, it's about this princess who gets captured by demons, and she's all relieved because she's like, oh, now I can have a vacation. And so she has to terrorize the demons in her quest for a perfect night's sleep, right? So she's like, oh, I want bed sheets, and like goes and like kills some demons because they have like perfect bed sheets. Like, it's amazing. I love that show so much.
I need you to pitch every story, everything you've talked about today. I'm like buying that, watching that. Oh. Like,
also, my next life as a villainess was like, it hit like the perfect note the sweetest for me.
I'm just like, it's so amazing. Good. I love that show so much.
Also, Skate the Infinity, like it hasn't wrapped up yet, but it's so good. And Horimiya,
I love Horimiya. Yes,
it's so good.
Shelby and I are like, this is like our AO3 moment. It feels like where we're like,
it all sounds amazing. Haven't seen any of it. Sounds amazing.
Like, right.
Everybody. Well, that's the other thing. Everybody needs to watch Horimiya because like the way that they approach the emotions and inner lives of like teenagers is just, it's beautiful. It's profound. I love it so, so much. Cause I was like, if I had a show like this when I was younger, maybe I would have understood my emotions a little bit more.
Like Horimiya is up there with Fruits Baskets for me. Like, it's just, it is. Oh, I am going to cry. Season 3 comes out this year. I can't stand it.
Wow.
Sorry.
I know. This
is what happens when you get two anime geeks in the same place together.
Right.
So we're going to swap Rex later, right?
Yes. 100%. Yes. Well, I think we are just about out of time. But I want to thank all of you for such an amazing panel. So thank you, Namina and Ashley and Adam and Shelby. Thank you for your honesty and all of your great advice and all the recs. Oh my gosh.
Oh my god, yeah.
I know. So I can write everything down.
Recs for days.
Yes. And for all of our viewers out there, thank you so much for watching. And please tell your friends to watch too. I know that everyone is zoomed out and tired of looking at computer screens or watching on TV, but we have so many great panels, and I would love for you and your friends to, even if you have to watch them virtually together, I would love for you to get together and watch them. Please check out our other panels, visit our websites, buy all the books that we talked about today. Also buy some NTTBF swag. Oh, showing our books again. Yay. Hooray for all of these wonderful books, and thank you. And we are done. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.